All right, listeners, I think you know that we are part of the Radiotopia Network, which is basically a network built on the idea that you should support the most creative, independent audio makers around. No one, and I mean no one, embodies the Radiotopia ethos more than Benjamin Walker and his show, Theory of Everything. Benjamin, who I've known for a long time, has been making beautiful, personal, sprawling audio documentaries for decades that help us understand the very strange world we live in. And now he has a new series called Not All Propaganda is Art. The new series goes back to the 1950s, when Western security agencies like the CIA paid artists, writers, and intellectuals to fight the cultural Cold War.
The CIA funds were free. I mean, no one was told what to say.
Gloria Steinem, activist who sees the CIA as a sort of enlightened pal or rich uncle, there is another viewpoint.
Look, if you're listening to this show, I know you like secret histories. I know you like a mix of culture and politics and shadowy figures. So what are you waiting for? Not All Propaganda is Art from Benjamin Walker. You can find it now wherever you listen or at theoryofeverythingpodcast.com. Hello and welcome to This Day in Esoteric Political History from Radiotopia. My name is Jody Avergan. This day, it's July 4th. There are lots of ways that we could mark this day, but we are going to go to 1845, the 4th-ish of July, when a Texas convention in Austin ratified the decision for Texas to join the United States. After about a decade or so of being its own republic, it was now taking very concrete steps towards joining the USA, which it would do later that fall. This was a very long and winding path to this moment. Lots of questions about expansion and slavery and the Louisiana Purchase, and of course, conflicts and confusion with Mexico. The Great Britain even gets up in there for a little bit too. So let's talk about all of this and this larger question, which is sort of lingering, of does Texas really want to be part of the United States? Because that is actually feeling like a pretty salient question right now, given that the Texas GOP put it in their platform just recently that Texas has the right to secede, and they called for a referendum next year to determine whether or not the state of Texas should reassert its status as an independent nation. Gosh, this stuff feels really real right now. It's incredible, you know? Yeah. And, you know, we're living in one of those moments where, sure, everything feels on the table, including this. So maybe there are some interesting clues in history around the 4th of July, 1845. Here to discuss, as always, are Nicole Hemmer of Columbia and Kelly Carter Jackson of Wellesley. Hello there.
Howdy, Jody.
There you go.
Hey there. I can't.
One of those people grew up in Texas and one of them did not. I'll let you guess which one.
Oh my gosh. Howdy is all I hear, especially because like my whole family is like Texas A&M alum. And so howdy is just how you greet people. But yeah, I'm really excited to talk about this because I feel like for all of our Texas listeners out there, like Texas history is just so entrenched in the curriculum. Mm-hmm. Like you have to know this. And there's so much pride about Texas being like its own country, you know, like that feeling is very much palpable even to this very day.
Yeah. And I mean, growing up and getting that curriculum, I mean, did you also come to understand just the wild twists and turns? Because, for instance, there's this in a 50-year span, Texas, I think we did the math here, our researcher Jacob did the math, but you know, in a 50-year span from 1820 to 1870, Texas is part of Spain, part of Mexico, independent, part of the U.S., part of the Confederate States, part of the U.S. again. And then, of course, this moment, you know, 1845 is what we're talking about when it's going back into the U.S. But, I mean, did you grow up with that impression that, like, gosh, we were just
it's a lot.
Up for grabs?
I knew it was messy. I knew it was complicated. It's probably the best way to put it. I knew all about, you know, Sam Houston. I knew about, like, the Brazos River. I knew about places like Nacogdoches, like, with all of these funny names and things. You know, that was a part of our, you know, it's like state trivia, if you will. You had to know all of these people. So I've forgotten, unfortunately, a lot of it. So it's nice to be reminded, but it's very long and windy. And I'm not even sure that a lot of Texans appreciate just how complicated it is.
Yeah.
And interesting because, you know, growing up in Indiana, we also had kind of the state history curriculum, but it would last for like a semester in fourth grade. And it wasn't a core part of identity. And I think that one of the things we'll explore here is the idea of Texan identity as something that is particularly strong because of not just the number of different alliances it had, but that spate of independence for a decade in the 1800s really does have a lasting effect on how Texans see themselves.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But one really interesting thing, and so if we hone in on this moment, this 10-year period where, you know, 1836 to 1845, which is the moment we're marking here, and we have the Republic of Texas, and then it turns into, you know, let's become part of the United States. When Texas declared independence from Mexico in 1836, it applied for annexation to the United States that same year and was rejected by the Secretary of State, though. And then shortly after, you know, President Andrew Jackson recognizes this new country. And so maybe we should understand that in context of why the United States is wary of taking on Texas as a new state in that late 30s, early 40s stretch.
Oh, man. I mean, slavery?
What explains all of 19th century history?
I really walked you up to that one. Yeah.
That's my answer for everything, slavery. I mean, slavery is a huge part of this predicament because, and this is from the 1830s all the way up until we get to the Civil War, with every new state or territory, for that matter, that comes into the United States, there's always an intense debate over, is this going to be a free state or a slave state? Is this going to count politically toward most of the southern states, or is this going to be a boon for northern states? And so Texas is a massive territory, and you know there are tens of thousands of enslaved people living in the state at the time, and so it became a real political question about whether or not Texas should or could be included and how that would fare for other southern states.
Right. And you don't have the same kind of gradual process that you have with other states that were entering the Union at the time, because you would have these, you know, areas organized into territories that were under the control of the United States. You would have to wait until their populations hit something like 50,000. Mm-hmm. But with Texas, it had already been an independent country. It had built up its population. So the decision was not to introduce Texas as, or to annex Texas as a territory. It was going to be a state, and it was going to be a big state with a lot of enslaved people in it. And so it had a political volatility that wasn't necessarily the case for other states. Although as you get into the 1840s and 50s, everything gets pretty volatile.
Yeah. And a political volatility internally, but also more interestingly with Mexico as well, because Mexico had outlawed slavery. Mexico was still claiming, you know, its rogue territory to the north of Texas as sort of contested territory. It still wanted to hold on to that territory. And so if the United States takes on Texas and has to decide the slavery question for Texas, it really also then pits them against Mexico, who had solved its own, or not solved, but who had decided its own stance on slavery. And so there's all of these interesting competing dynamics, but of course, all running through that basic lens of the slavery question.
Yeah, in Texas at the time, the president of Texas, Marabou Lamar, is also really pushing this vision of a Texan empire in which Texas rivals the United States for supremacy and for economic and political control. And then this is interesting too, because Texas starts to say, okay, well, if the United States won't be in conversation with this, Great Britain, how about you? I want to make a deal. Let's trade. And that becomes the way that the UK also gets brought into this conversation as well, because they are seeing Texas as a viable trading partner for themselves.
Right, because Texas at this point is an independent nation. And so it is recognized by other countries. It has trade relations with other countries. And that's a powerfully unsettling thing on a continent that had been and was still sort of the plaything of empires. All of these independent countries emerging and all of the new trade relations and the ways that empires were playing these new nations off of one another. We see it with the United States and Canada, but we also see it with Texas as this new independent nation in North America.
Yeah. File this under stories we'll do in the future, but the election by which Lamar becomes president of the Texas Republic in 1838, apparently that election was just wild, in part because two of the leading candidates committed suicide within a span of 48 hours, sort of clearing the path for Lamar, who Sam Houston apparently hated. And, you know, so like, but gosh, two candidates. I mean, you're a new country. You've been a country for like the blink of an eye. You're trying to have an election, and all of a sudden, two of the your leading sort of figures commit suicide. And I mean, that's just
suicide, yeah, incredible. Or murder. Yeah.
Well, we will figure that out. You save that. We'll figure that out. And when we do that episode in the future. But, you know, this question of annexation and the Texas Republic, I mean, certainly there's this window in, I think 38 to 42 or something, where largely it's like, we're going to be our own independent nation, you know, go, go, go. But I do think there is still always this question of, is it best to ask to be annexed by the United States? And by 1843 or so, John Tyler is president of the United States, and he really makes it one of his political priorities to bring Texas into the fold. Do we have any sense of why that's such a big priority for Tyler and how he navigates the question of slavery?
So one of the reasons that Tyler is so interested in this is because Tyler is a really unusual American president. He doesn't represent any particular political party. And so as he's thinking about the base of his power going forward, the annexation of Texas brings in new citizens, it brings in new electoral votes, it placates the South because it is a state where slavery exists. And so Tyler makes a play not just for bringing Texas in, but expanding the country, which is still something that has a lot of power in U.S. politics. And that's precisely what he does. He makes arrangements within his own cabinet in order to make this possible. Daniel Webster had been his Secretary of State. Daniel Webster was opposed to the annexation of Texas. So Tyler gonna pushes him out and puts in place somebody who is really pro-Texas annexation. And that's the moment when, in 1843, Tyler really starts aggressively pursuing the annexation of Texas.
Yeah, and so much so that even when he's no longer president and Polk comes into office, Polk really picks up that baton where Tyler left off and says, okay, we're going to push for this. We're going to make sure that Mexico will not invade, you know, if we do this deal. And within a short amount of time, you know, Texas is facing statehood by March of 1845. The Lone Star Republic is basically a state.
Yeah, I mean, so it is funny. I mean, you really do get the sense that Tyler used all of his remaining political capital in the last 6 months or so of his presidency to pull this off, including, we talked about this, you know, in the Room Where It Happens episode, of, including taking on Texas's debt of up to $10 million. And that's part of the secret negotiation here in this treaty that they basically put together. And, you know, so on the one hand, it's like, wow, Tyler really uses all this political capital, does a backroom deal, assumes this debt, signs a treaty, gets it all set up, ready to go. The other way of looking at it is he kind of just like negotiates this thing. And like March 1st, it's like, okay, we got this great deal with Texas. And March 3rd is his last day in office. And then he's just like, I'm out. Good luck with that whole Texas thing, Polk. You know, and then this vote that we're marking here, July 4th in 1845. I mean, one way to look at it is it's obviously the Texas legislature saying, okay, we want annexation, and then that puts the gears into motion. One way of looking at it is almost them sort of like pro forma acknowledging a deal that had already been cut. And it's sort of saying, okay, yes, this is happening. We're moving forward. Polk's on board. Tyler did his thing. But I do like that notion of literally the last day in office, Tyler just signs this thing and is like, have fun dealing with Texas for the next 120 years.
And Texas, I mean, you know, the Texas prides itself on being huge, enormous. I mean, it literally adds so much to the size of the United States since, what, the Louisiana Purchase?
Yep.
So, I mean, by 1850, when they're doing the first census of Texas, you know, it has over 212,000 people in its state, including 58,000 enslaved people. So, I mean, Texas is no small feather in the United States' cap, if you will, and adds a lot economically for sure.
Or one sort of indication of that, I think, is that right up until the very last moment, obviously, like, Mexico is very interested in retaining Texas. And the British sort of get in this last-ditch effort in the spring of 1845 to broker a deal by which Mexico will finally offer the independent Texas Republic peace and recognition and, you know, try and do some trade treaties and so forth. And it's too late at that point, right? But I just love the notion of like the British finally jumping in and being like, whoa, maybe like we do want this as an independent country. Nope, because obviously I think that they're watching the U.S. empire mm-hmm. grow and realizing, oh gosh, you know, but too late. And so we arrive at this moment, and you know, it's July that the Texas legislature ratifies this treaty. Texas is admitted into the Union as the 28th state in December of that same year. So I mean, it's really kind of the dominoes start to fall pretty fast at this point.
It becomes a state, but the U.S. then has to fight to keep it one, because the Mexican-American War almost immediately starts over Texas and over the boundaries of Texas. And for the next 3 years, that's going to define the Polk administration is this war with Mexico that's triggered by the annexation.
We've been talking about all the twists and turns here and all the kind of like backroom deals and so forth. I mean, it is worth taking a step back and realizing kind of how monumental a moment this is. And there's a politician by the name of Thomas Jefferson Rusk. It's important to say all three, because if you just stop at two, then you think you're talking about someone else. But his name is Thomas Jefferson Rusk of Nacogdoches. And he was the president of this convention. He said, sort of when this deal was ratified, he says, quote, "The history of the world may be searched in vain for a parallel to the present instance of two governments amalgamating themselves into one from a pure devotion to that great principle that man, by enlightening his intellect and cultivating those moral sentiments with which God has impressed them, is capable of self-government." So there really is a spirit of a real understanding of kind of what's happening here in terms of building a big country, and that, as we said, you know, a country that could have remained its own independent republic and would have subsisted probably was able to band itself together. And I mean, you read that quote in the context of, as I mentioned, what's happening today, and some of those sort of high-minded ideas, I don't know, they're still being floated, or they're being used in the other direction, or what, I don't know. And so I don't know if you have any reflections on kind of the current state of Texas and the notion of secession,
you know,
and all
it's
that
funny
stuff.
I just remember, maybe this was in college, where there were like conversations about Texas sort of becoming its own, you know, country again. And there was a big push in the city of Austin to say that if Texas secedes, like Austin wants to secede from Texas. So like the political lines, I think, are really interesting when you go from city to city throughout Dallas and Austin and Houston. The political makeups vary, that's for sure.
And in that quote, Jody, you know, it talks about the present instance of two governments amalgamating themselves into one. It presents Texas as an equal partner to the United States, right? Yeah. That their two governments are merging, not that Texas is being annexed and subsumed by the United States. And I think that that's a big tell about this idea of the importance of the republic to Texan identity, that we were an independent, separate government and we can become one again. And I think that that spirit infuses a lot of the secessionist talk today and a lot of the ways that Texans see themselves as a state that really opted to become part of the United States and can opt out whenever it liked. And it certainly did, you know.
Right. It did. I was
15
just
years
say, in
after,
the Civil War.
After it became a state.
In the Civil War, they're like, okay, we're with you. We're out.
Yeah. I mean, of course, you know, this is, I know, like, naive and a very generous reading of that. But, you know, I also see in that quote a spirit of, we understand that we could opt out, but we see the power of opting in. And, you know, to me, that's the kind of power of the American experiment that seems to not be there. And now people are just retreating to just the first part of that, which is we can opt out, we can tribalize, we can go to our camps and our states and fracture everything. And I think, you know, this country has always, in theory, been about recognizing that you can do that, but understanding that there's something better that happens when you actually band together. And I don't, and that spirit seems to be completely eroded at this moment.
Well, I like you recapturing that original ideal. That's a,
I know, for just a quick second, I felt hopeful.
I did
like,
too.
Oh, yeah, well, yes.
I'm saying it, unfortunately, in the context of feeling very unhopeful.
Oh, yeah, to be clear, like, you snuffed out that flame almost immediately.
Yeah. Okay, good.
Say it louder for the people in the back.
Fair enough. Okay. Well, look, I'm always one to end on a hopeful note, even though everyone I know will hear some of my voice and our voices. But, all right, that brings us to the end of the episode. Nicole Hammer, thanks to you.
Thank you, Jody.
And Kellie Carter-Jackson, thanks to you.
My pleasure. That's right, you're not from Texas. Texas wants you anyway. That's right, you're not from Texas.
That's right, you're not from Texas. That's right, you're not from Texas. Texas, won't you anyway? That's right, you're not from Texas. That's right, you're not from Texas. That's right, you're not from Texas. Texas, won't you anyway? That's right, you're not from Texas. That's right, you're not from Texas. That's right, you're not from Texas. Texas, won't you anyway? Texas, won't you anyway?
Radiotopia.